This film was released in 1946, not long after the end of World War II. And when it was ready to be shown overseas in Germany, there was such a dislike of films dealing with Nazis that some tricky editing and redubbing had to be done on the film to make it acceptable to German audiences. What the distributor did was change the title to White Poison and redub the dialogue so that the story had nothing to do with Nazi spies or the Third Reich. It became instead about an international drug smuggling operation. When Alicia and Devlin go down to the cellar and find that uranium in the bottle, what they found in the German version was cocaine. World War II was never mentioned, and it wasn't until two decades later that German audiences finally were able to see the original version of Notorious with its uranium and its Nazis. Coming up next, another Hitchcock film, this one set in Morocco, with Jimmy Stewart and Doris Day.
Tonight on Turner Classic Movies, our spotlight on assassination plots continues with Alfred Hitchcock's political thriller, The Man Who Knew Too Much. Then assassin Frank Sinatra places his crosshairs on the president in Suddenly. And bank teller Sinatra searches for an honest way to make an extra buck in Double Dynamite. Turner Classic Movies is open all night.
It's a shame him dying like that.
In the twilight of a war.
He was about the worst racketeer that ever made a dirty living in this city.
Angles shift. Lines blur.
I think you did it.
Shadows grow.
These were murders.
And the truth is as elusive as a ghost.
Come out, whoever you are.
One lost soul.
Harry!
A double life illuminated. The Third Man, October 11th at 8 p.m. with an encore at 11:15 on Turner Classic Movies.
In a musical, when someone sings, all the emotions are heightened. So if someone is in love, the fact that you're adding music and dance to that just sends it to another level.
You're like Paris in April and May. You're New York on a silvery day.
In Royal Wedding, when Fred Astaire dances on the ceiling, what greater way to say you are in love than to be so in love that your dancing leaves the floor and goes above. And there are moments like that that can only be done with music and dance.
Seven Brides for Seven Brothers is a great movie musical because it's blow away. There are moments in it that are just blow away. It's just insane what these guys do. They're dancing on logs, they're throwing hatchets, they're flipping on trees, they're sliding off roofs. It is magnificent choreography done by extraordinary dancers, shot great. If you get through that number and you don't go, oh my God, roll that back, play it again, you're not a human being.
West Side Story was groundbreaking on Broadway and in the movie, and that had a lot to do with Jerome Robbins. His choreography really was molded around the characters. For example, he has the sharks dance one way. And the jets dance another way.
Even though their toes are pointed and they're leaping and they're turning and they're spotting as they turn, because he's telling them, this is a karate move, this is a punch, this is a kick, this is jump higher than the guy next to you, nothing was a dance step. Everything was storytelling, everything was character. And he transformed dancers into actors every time. They had to be impeccable dancers, or God know he would chew them up and spit them out. But they had to be actors first and foremost, and that is his brilliance.
In Jerome Robbins' work in Fiddler on the Roof, one of the most famous dances that we have in theater history is the bottle dance.
Jewish folk dance doesn't exist. So how do you create Jewish folk movement? He went to Hasidic weddings and Hasidic celebrations all over the United States, and then to Russia, to Poland, to the old villages, and sat in on ceremonies and watched how the men danced. They're all just expressing their own thing. He saw somebody go. He went, oh, gotta write that down. And he cobbled together a dance vocabulary for that film. So his research was impeccable. His determination that dance was going to come from culture, from history, from character, was extraordinary.
My favorite movies are the ones that involve backstage musicals, like 42nd Street.
Stop it! Stop it! Stop it! It's brutal! If it isn't asking too much, will you please show me a little? All right, now, once again, give it something! Come on, ready, Jerry? Get into it now! Come on!
And as a choreographer, Busby Berkeley has a great influence on Broadway. And what he is known for, and what we remember from the films, is that the camera was above the dance, and you would look down onto the dancers, where they would make different formations, flowers, and patterns.
That had to be heart-stopping, because you could not do that on a stage. How could you see these dancers from that angle sitting in the audience of a theater? What was revelatory is to not shoot the way Fred and Gene often did, which was just shoot it as if I'm dancing on a proscenium stage. Just follow me, which has its merits and is often glorious. But to actually take that camera and put it somewhere an audience had never gone before is mind-blowing.
As a choreographer, everything that I've ever seen in these wonderful movie musicals will be applied to my musicals.
The proper rhythm, writhing, beating rhythm.
When the orchestra swells and the actress feels the emotion and the camera goes up and that melody is happening and the orchestration is perfect and it looks fantastic and you just go, life is good. It lifts you in a way that non-musicals cannot do.
Step into a day of movie musicals with our Mad About Musicals Festival. Tuesdays and Wednesdays this month here on Turner Classic Movies.
I was a seasoned performer of 17 when I first worked with Judy Garland. And all I had to do was take one look at this beautiful girl before the cameras, and I knew that she had it. She had that magic.
The stars you're seeing have all returned to MGM, the studio that invented the movie musical. They were a part of an era of entertainment unlike any other the world has ever known.
And let me tell you, for a little girl with a wild imagination, this place was heaven.
I have never seen it.
They're all here for one reason, to join their talents for the first and only time in one motion picture. They've come together in a kind of labor of love. It will never happen again. Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer, producers of the most magnificent movie musicals in all of Hollywood's history, proudly presents the greatest musical of them all. With special appearances by Elizabeth Taylor, Fred Astaire, Gene Kelly, James Stewart, Debbie Reynolds, Mickey Rooney, Bing Crosby, Liza Minnelli, Donald O'Connor, Peter Lawford, Frank Sinatra, with Judy Garland, Jane Powell, Clark Gable, Catherine Grayson, Jean Harlow, Joan Crawford. That's entertainment. It's more than a movie, it's a celebration.
Glorious feeling, we're happy again. pretending you're a dancer with grace. You wiggle till they're jiggling all over the place.
Shout hallelujah, get happy, get ready for your judgment day. Come on, get happy, chase your cares away. Shout hallelujah, come on, get happy, get ready for the judgment day. Sun is shining, come on, get happy. Lord is waiting to take your hand.
Nights, your name in lights, why we won't stop till you reach the top.
Thump, 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 when my heart strings, when he smiled I could feel a car shake.
New York, New York, a wonderful town, the Bronx is up and the Battery.
You'll never see the likes of this again.
That's entertainment. Boy, do we need it now.
Few characters have cemented themselves into television audiences' hearts and minds quite like Fred Mertz. For 9 years, people not only loved Lucy, they came to love the stingy landlord brought to life by William Frawley. Like many of his contemporaries, Frawley began his career in vaudeville. Leaving his hometown of Burlington, Iowa, where he was born in 1887, Frawley toured with piano player Franz Rath. Though their act, entitled A Man, A Piano, and a Nut, was moderately successful, Frawley soon ditched the nut and the piano, and in 1932 landed in Hollywood under contract to Paramount.
Here's your big chance. Mm-hmm.
Over the next 20 years, Frawley gained a reputation as a hard-drinking sourpuss. And it wasn't much of a stretch to lend his personality to the screen.
Shut up.
Sometimes bumbling.
By using your head.
Right.
Sometimes shady.
Let's not pay too much attention about breaking clean and hitting in the clenches. Let's have a nice, clean, dirty fight.
And almost always grumpy.
The best I hope for them is they hang them.
Frawley played roughly the same gruff but sentimental guy in over 100 films.
What are you trying to do, make a dumb fiction cop out of me?
In late 1950, Frawley caught wind of a project that belonged to an acquaintance, and he campaigned hard to become part of the proposed sitcom. Lucille Ball barely remembered her Ziegfeld Follies castmate, but she knew his reputation, and she was not prepared to cast a man with Frawley's drinking habit in her pet project.
Why not? Give him a chance, can't you?
After a little negotiation with CBS, and a stern promise that he would never drink during working hours, Frawley got the job. When I Love Lucy ended in 1960, Frawley set up shop taking sons. Frawley remained a member of the Douglas family for 5 years before health problems forced his retirement. He was replaced in the role by William Demarest's Uncle Charlie. Frawley's health continued to decline, but his love for movies never did.
You never seen a movie?
Not a real one.
Well, it sounds un-American to me.
On March 3rd, 1966, when he collapsed on Hollywood Boulevard after seeing a movie, both Frawley and a little piece of Hollywood died. Looking back on his career before his death, Frawley dismissed his time in Hollywood, saying, "I was in a few pictures, maybe one or two good ones. I just took the money and ran."
There's no use taking a chance.
William Frawley. What a character.
This month at TurnerClassicMovies.com, check out our movie musical sale and shopping, featuring new-to-DVD titles with savings up to 25% off the purchase price, including the That's Entertainment trilogy. Choose from our new line of fall gift items, including calendars, movie posters, and In the Picture, a new book of production stills from the TCM archives. And we celebrate 50 years of the Hollywood musical in our Mad About Musicals tribute, with photos, trailers, trivia, and more. It's all happening in October on TurnerClassicMovies.com.
Hi, I'm Robert Osborne. Our next film also comes from the master of suspense, Alfred Hitchcock, one he made exactly 10 years after our last movie, Notorious. This is the movie called The Man Who Knew Too Much, from Paramount Pictures in 1956, starring James Stewart and Doris Day as a couple vacationing in Morocco who soon find themselves caught up in a plot to assassinate a diplomat. Now, it's a story that was already familiar territory to Hitchcock because he had already told it on film once before, under the same title as well. The original version was made in England in 1935, long before Hitchcock made his first trip to Hollywood. That earlier version starred Leslie Banks and Edna Best as the couple. Well, 21 years later, Hitch decided to remake it, the only film of his that he didn't make. For this version, he filmed it in Technicolor, and he changed the locale from Switzerland to Morocco. He also created a much more lavish production this time and changed the film's length as well. The original ran just a little over an hour. This new version runs a full 2 hours. Hitch said he was very happy with his newer version. He said the first adaptation was the work of a talented amateur. The second, he felt, was made by a professional. This movie, by the way, was the first one in which Doris Day sings Que Sera Sera, the song which won the Academy Award and became a standard for her. She later sang it again in the 1960 comedy Please Don't Eat the Daisies. She sang it again after that in 1966 in the movie The Glass Bottom Boat. But here it's very much an integral part of the plot and the suspense. From 1956, The Man Who Knew Too Much.